Hey, Tal.
Hey, Jeff.
How are you?
Yeah. Good, good. How are you?
Good. You're calling from Israel, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you can hear me okay? See me okay?
Yeah, I see you fine.
Okay, good. Thanks
for... Can you hear me good?
Yeah, I can. You're perfect.
Awesome.
So we've got 15 minutes. Let's get right into it. What do we got? What do we got going on?
Okay, so I got a year and a half old German Shepherd. She's not neutered. And recently, like, I want to say a month or two, she started showing signs of aggression towards strangers off-leash, mainly off-leash. She's growling and sometimes barking at children. And she, give or take, not consistently and not excessively, shows pulling on leash. Okay. And I do use a 3.2 millimeter prong collar. Right now, I don't have the money to invest in an A-collar, okay, but it's my next purchase.
Okay.
All right. That's about it.
Okay.
Otherwise, she's well-behaved, she's well-obedient, she's good.
Excellent. So let's address the pulling right away. We'll just eliminate that right off the bat. If you don't have the money for a prong collar, I mean, sorry, for a remote collar, there's a video that I've got on my YouTube channel. It's called the 180 move. It's with a Rottweiler. Just so if you go into my channel and just type in 180 move, you'll see it. And, it's sort of like a, inspired by the Keeler method of dog training. It's highly effective. A little bit invasive, to a lot invasive, but what it does is it gets the dog to stop all the nonsense of, like, looking around, edging forward. It prevents you from constantly nagging the dog. What it does is it gets that dog to realize that there's somebody at the end of the leash. A lot of dogs, for some reason, are just not like... Like, if you drop the leash, the dog would just, like, keep walking. It's like, it doesn't get that you actually have got a leash in your hand and the dog should be focused on you. So the 180 move, what it does, it actually, light bulb moment for the dog, it actually goes, oh, like, Tal is here and I should be paying attention. And it's actually done with no words. It's an unspoken protocol. So try that. It's definitely a very firm correction that you're doing. But the cool thing is you don't have to nag your dog, and it really, really sends a message home that it's like, hey, you really need to pay attention to me. Then what you want to do is, when you are getting that attention, if you are getting the right position, you want to use your marker words of good or yes, depending what your marker word is. I find it hard to deliver a food reward while you're in motion. I'm a family dog trainer, not a competition dog trainer. I understand with competition, it's constant. That's not what I do. You absolutely, though, can give marker words for that. So that's one of the protocols that we do for that. What also we do is, if you're healing your dog on the left-hand side and your dog tends to inch in front of you, what I'll do a lot of is I'll make very, very quick left-hand turns into the dog. So what I'm looking for, I'm looking for a dog to yield to its handler. So if you're, walking like this, and if you're making that left-hand turn, and if you keep bumping into the dog, number one, it means the dog is ahead of you. But even if the dog was heeling next to you and you make these quick turns and hitting the dog, that means the dog does not have spatial awareness of where you actually are. So what I'm doing is I'm looking for a dog to almost, to literally be in sync, to always be parallel to me. When you do that, you've got a dog that's got situational awareness of where you are, they're yielding to your body pressure, and they're actually focused more on you than everything else. And that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
I'm looking for a dog to be aware of me and forget about everything else. Now, when you're off leash, you don't have to do that. But when you have an off leash dog that's you didn't use the word attack, but is it biting?
She's not a biter. Like, from all the times I went to a park with her off leash, it happened twice ever since I got that she ran at someone with aggressive intentions.
Yes.
And only once she ever grabbed someone, like, she grabbed his pants. Like, she didn't bite him, but she grabbed him in his pants.
Okay.
And that, like, that, I went blank. Like, I I did not know what to do at that point.
Right.
It's the first time I've ever had.
Yeah. So, you know, totally unacceptable. That's why you're calling. It's very, very common for an owner to just be like deer in headlights, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe my dog just did that, and you freeze. And it actually happens more than you would think. A lot of owners freeze when it comes to stuff like that, where we would be like, number one, we would jump in. But what you need to do is, right now, you're gonna have to fall in love with the long line so you can get, you know, whether it's a, you know, 15 meter long line or, a little bit longer, you can get it very, very thin, just so the dog drags it behind it. So the dog does not have the opportunity to rush people. You can also practice your recalls. You can hook it up to your prong collar. What I would do is anytime your dog is starting to focus on people to target them, you want to make sure you can deliver, a punisher to that dog, that it's not allowed to do that. Now, I'm not opposed to dogs looking at people, but what's the dog's intention? So we always want to think intent. So if a dog is sort of like targeting and loading and like chest forward, ears up, the breathing is stopped. So that's really good, your dog's not going to be like, I think I want to say hello. It's going to be, I'm thinking naughty thoughts, I'm going to go after you, whether that's just to bark at you, to rush you and scare you, or worst case scenario, to bite you. None of it's acceptable. That's when you would want to deliver your punisher. You can use a bonker. So a bonker is a wrapped up towel, if you've seen any of our videos with bonkers. So that's, you can use that, and you would say the word no, wait 1 second, 2 seconds, and then deliver the punisher. Remember, all punishers have to be inevitable. So if you're going to use the word no, there has to be a consequence. If you don't have a way to deliver a consequence, you can always say like, something like that. But don't water down the word no. If you speak to...
Up until now, what I was doing is grabbing her by the foreskin in the back and in her butt area.
Yes.
And just putting her to the ground, put my knee on her.
Yeah.
No, like I'm very assertive about it.
Yeah.
Like when it comes to the nose, she knows she's not allowed. But it's like, a switch in her head just turned on and she just ignored everything. Like I had no idea what to do at that point.
So I'm not a big fan of alpha rolling. I'm not a big fan of manhandling like that. I mean, it doesn't make you a bad person. It doesn't make you a bad dog owner. If I had no other resources, and my dog was like thinking about going after somebody, I mean, I would probably tackle my dog because it's like, it's either that or damage.
Yeah.
That's why we love remote collars so much, because we can stay super calm. We can just say no, and your remote can whisper or shout. So that's why I like about that. So we get to keep calm energy. When we keep calm energy, and even if we deliver a high-level consequence to the dog, you actually don't lose trust in your dog. It's when you start getting emotional with your dog and in a negative form and start, manhandling or doing what you did, your dog might listen. Your dog probably listened. It did stop. You did prevent your dog. But that's going to ruin, I think, that one event's not going to ruin the bond. But I prefer not to do that. If it was like life or death, what do I care? I mean, I can care less what you do, because you're like, it's either that or a human emergency room bill or a vet bill. But, they've got, I don't know what the prices in Israel are of a good quality remote collar. I don't know if there's a distributor there. If Amazon is delivering there.
Like I said, I wrote it on the message. I want to order from your website because I don't trust any other companies that make it.
Yeah.
You go online, there's so many, you don't know which of them are high quality, low quality.
Right. So we don't deliver out of the country. So, but if you can go on to Amazon, see if Amazon delivers, maybe there's a distributor. If you've got, you've got, Israel's got a really good working dog program. So you've got, most of your military there are using remote collars. They are. Dogtro would be okay, and e-collar technology would be okay. And I'm sure they use one of those. They must, because those are the higher quality ones. U.S. prices are under $200 U.S. I don't know if there's probably going to be a more of a charge into Israeli money, but also the exporting fee might be a little bit higher, but it's well worth it. You might be able to find a used one, if it's good, if it's a good used one, then it works. you know, you can do that. We've got free videos. You can teach yourself how to do it. It's not, believe it or not, it's easier than most people think. Everybody's like, oh no, you need a professional dog trainer. No, you don't. Like, you can take apart a car engine with YouTube. Like, you know, it'll take you more time than a professional mechanic, but it can be done. So I would do that. And what I would do is I would start thinking about intent, Tal. Intent. What's my dog thinking? And what happens is with a lot of folks is they start seeing their dog target people or target dogs, and they're like, well, maybe this time the dog won't misbehave. You know what? Not to think negative, punish. Punish. Don't even, you can't think naughty thoughts. You just can't. The dog's not going to go from naughty thought and then go, oh, I don't need to, I'm not going to do that. Now, once rehab starts going, you are going to see this messy middle, this little bit of confusion where the dog is going to go. But before you even say anything, it's going to turn away because you've trained it to turn away. So right now we're sort of doing a little bit of avoidance. We're doing avoidance training, which says, you know what, you just can't stare at people. Eventually, that'll switch to the dog being able to exist around people. But right now, nope, you can't do it. You can't do it.
Okay. The next thing is she's very jumpy.
Okay.
If I walk her, especially at night, like even if there's like a bag in the wind, she'll suddenly perk up and, you know, get a bit startled. Or she sees something in the bush and hears some noise. She's very jumpy towards becoming, like, protective.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, it's a German Shepherd trait.
Yep.
But I sometimes feel like she's overdoing it.
Yep.
So
one of the traits of a German Shepherd is they're obviously, they're wary of strangers. They are, you know, they do go into protection mode. But nobody, paper bags are not trying to hurt you. So I don't think there's been any incident of a paper bag hurting a human being, you know, unless it's put over somebody's head and your hands are tied behind your back with duct tape. But that's, you know, that's probably not going to happen. That's probably not going to happen to you. So you know, there's I don't know about your news media, but we're not hearing about a rash of paper bag, you know, injuries. Yeah. So what you're going to do is this. It's, again, it's just unacceptable behavior. And at nighttime, the dog might be on higher alert. I know I personally am always more situationally aware at night wherever I am, just because it's night and that's just how I decide to, you know, always be more situationally aware. So I think but that's your job, to be situational aware, not your dog. Yeah. So, because chances are if somebody's walking down the street, they're probably going to be friendly. Yeah. So I would hate to see your dog go into protection mode with somebody friendly. And a lot of times people will say, well, that's the trait of the dog. Actually, no, it's not, because it's, if you're in danger, it's the trait of the dog, but not when you're not. So I don't want an overprotective a dog of any breed, because it's going to make walking down the street very, very difficult. So what you can do, the thing about the remote collar again, is when you start seeing arousal, it's going to be a punisher. And the dog's gonna go, oh, what do I care about paper bags? What do I care about paper bags? After a while, when you start walking by stimuli that used to set your dog off, throw a marker word at it, good or yes, depending on what your marker word is, be consistent with it. So now the dog goes, ah, I didn't react. I got verbal praise. If you wanna deliver a food reward, you can. If you wanna do physical touch, you're like a pet, you absolutely can. Mm-hmm. The missing link, though, is the punisher. So that's the balance. So you can't just reward the dog for not freaking out with the paper bag. You absolutely have to punish, which is, again, from a non-emotional state. It's just no, deliver with a remote, and the dog goes, oh, so I'm not supposed to be aroused around paper bags or plastic bags. No, you're not. Yep. No, you're not. So, and then the dog understands it. And then your no becomes a power word. Your no becomes a power word. And that's what we're looking for. We want to have meanings to our word.
Yeah. And one last thing is children. So I just came back to Israel from Canada. I lived there for 2 years. Around 6 to 8 months old, she met her first kid, and he was like, you know, very kid-like, hands in the air, very weird motions. And ever since, she became a bit very weary of children.
Yeah.
Now I got a 3-year-old nephew that I want him to meet her for the first time.
Yes.
And I'm kind of concerned about how that meeting will go.
Yeah.
But in general, whenever she sees children, she's like, wait a minute, that's not good.
So
she growls at them, she barks at them, yeah. And that kind of puts me even on more.
Yes.
So, okay, hold on. I need to give her like this much of a leash when I'm near children.
So a couple of things. Number one, you know, it's a two-way street. It's a two-way street. So, you know, how is the child around dogs? So, you know, a running around child, fine. A child like hugging a dog, absolutely not. A child, you know, poking at a dog, absolutely not. So we do have to take some responsibility for the child's actions as well. I'm a big advocate of existence. So you and your nephew and the dog can be like, go for a walk. Does your dog like to swim? Does your dog like to play fetch?
Yeah. Okay. She loves water except for bath. But
I know.
She loves water.
So, it's so weird, isn't it?
Like I threw her in a lake and she swam all the way to the middle, found the biggest stick she could find and dragged it all the way back.
Awesome.
Put her in a bathtub, ears go back.
I know. It's so funny. It's so funny. So the same with my dogs. You know, they put up with baths, but they sure as heck don't enjoy them. But they love the water. So what I would do is I would get your nephew to start being like, hey, you want to go swimming with the dog? And, you know, the dog, you know, your nephew can throw the stick or throw the ball. That's a good interaction. It's safe. It's probably predictable. Your dog is going to be focused on the game and the task, not as concerned about the child. That's fun stuff to do. Have you ever done any clicker training at all?
No, I'm not a big fan of clickers.
Okay, either was I for a while until I properly learned how to use them. I actually have been, you know, if you listen to my old podcast, I was very outspoken against them because I learned wrong.
Okay.
I actually learned wrong. So once I finally learned how to do them properly, I'm like, this is great. So all a clicker is a snapshot in time that says that was right and I will be delivering a food reward, you know, to you. So what you do, the way we do that around kids is what we're going to do is your dog's hanging out, your kid approaches, the dog is soft, click, you deliver the reward. Not the child. You deliver the reward.
Okay.
The child walks by. The dog just goes, you know, click, reward.
Yeah.
Open, closed mouth, punisher. Then all of a sudden, the child can walk by. What's the dog's name?
Zoe.
So the child could walk by. Hey, Zoe. And if the dog goes, hey, kid, boom, click, reward. So you want to do that. Now, if your dog does anything in a negative, there's got to be a punisher. So there has to be a punisher. A lot of times you'll hear online, well, if you punish the dog around kids, the dog will be, hate kids. The dog's already wary of kids. That had nothing to do with you. And you've never probably punished the dog around it. So no, it doesn't work that way. Then what's going to happen eventually, the goal is the child comes up to the dog and the child says, hey, Zoe. And you would click. And you could throw the dog the treat, but the child is doing the talking. So that would be the next step of that. But what you don't want to do right now is have the child reach with food. This thing of like sniff the hand and give the dog food, that doesn't work. Eventually, yes, food in the hand, dog goes, the child can reach for it. The dog sniffs, backs off a little bit, click, child opens up its hand. You know, but that's like step three or four. Most people do that as step one. And that's where they're running into trouble. If you don't want to use a clicker, you can use the word yes. But definitely mark what you want. The clicker is just you know, your yes tone might be different every day. But the clicker
is consistent.
Gets very consistent. Also, no matter whose hand the clicker is in, it sounds the same. So if you have three people working on that protocol, you've got three times as many people sounding all the same. So